yourself and send it to us. We're going to see that. We're going to pick out the best male, the best female, and we're going to be giving away some t-shirts as awards today for the very best. That's right, people. You from Ireland? Get on there and do it, Ireland people. Do it now. Facebook. Pro Watercross. Facebook.
Man, I tell you, it doesn't get any better than this when you've got Squatch delivered. This is better than drive up. I actually come to you and then I give you stuff. I know, right?
Who's better than you?
Nobody's. Well, okay, almost everybody. What's your name, sir?
Frank.
Frank, very nice to meet you. Where are you from?
Wallingford, Connecticut.
Oh, it's awesome to have you here. You on vacation?
Yes, ma'am.
Looking fly. Well, at least you're not sneaking away from work like some girls I know. All right, I got free jack links for you. Look, I tell you what. It's Sunday. I have to go back to work tomorrow. Clearly, I'm just goofing off today. But I'm going to just throw down a challenge here. First off, my name is Dawn Dawson, and I'm one of the announcers on the Pro Watercross National Tour. And here's my challenge. Are you ready? Because I'm ready. Here's my challenge. If you'll come up and dance with me right now, if you'll come dance with me right now,
go.
What's your name?
Addison.
Addison's very nice to meet you. High five. Woo! I'm going to get you hooked up with a fanny pack from Squatch. Are you ready? Let's go. Rick Ignacio, turn your music up, buddy. Anybody else that comes up here? One more person that comes up here, I will get you also hooked up with a fanny pack. What's your name?
Samantha.
Awesome, Samantha. Thank you. High five.
No, oh!
All right. Three amazing women on the beach right here in Atlantic City. Thank you guys so much.
All right, Don, I'm up in the tower, and somebody from England just posted. It's Elizabeth Lizzie Neely. I'm in England. The girl that posted earlier, that was the first one, and we were trying to call her out to come up here and get her free Squatch stuff. She's in England, hence she didn't make the trip. But how cool is that, that people are posting from around the world checking out this event, the fifth stop on the Pro Watercross National Tour right here in Atlantic City, New Jersey. This is big, folks. This is big. All right, we are prepping for that first race of the afternoon series. It'll be moto number 3 for Pro-Am Runabout Box Stock. Don, are you working your way back? Are you still dancing with the celebrities on the beach?
See, now here's the moment where I could totally fib, right? No, I'm coming back. Because I have to admit, this really isn't work. This is pretty much just a whole lot of fun. I am going to bring two beautiful young ladies with me over to the Squatch tent, and I'm going to hook them up with some fanny packs, and then I'm going to leave these guys alone to suntan and enjoy some racing, and I'm going to come hang out with you, Remar.
Down online, you've got Jeff Dykowski on the number 8 boat, 88 Michael Borges, 110 Troy Snyder, 116 Dustin Farley, 149 Tim Ducott, 247 Dylan Osborne, and 404 Brent Venderly. This is race number 14. Moto number 3 for the Pro-Am Runabout Box Stock. Just so you know, folks, these are pro riders, and they are riding box stock boats, which means you could buy one at your dealership and get out here and race it.
All right, Remar, coming back to you, sir.
All righty. So you're looking at a hole shot there on the outside split section as they come to this section right now. And I see a red flag out. I thought so. I saw a red flag come out. We are going to red this one. We're going to bring them back, re-rack them, repack them, restack them, and run this thing one more time. Rachel Piazza. Rachel Piazza, are you in the house? You are coming up for your t-shirt because you gave us some love. You went on to Pro Watercross on Facebook. You took a selfie, you sent us a picture, and we're gonna reward you for that. Rachel Piazza, can you come on up here to the Tower of Power? Come up here to the beach just in front of the tower. Rachel Piazza, Where are you at out there? Yeah, we need to get that social media photo. Rachel Piazza, as we reload the Pro-Am Runabout Box Stock Class. Rachel, we need you up here in front of the Tower of Power, right up here by the Pro Watercross tent. Okay, so Pro-Am Runabout.
Man, I tell you what, everybody's getting in on this Facebook action. Chris McCluggage, come on down for your free t-shirt. I'm pretty sure that we can get an autograph signing for you even. Meanwhile, oh, we've got a... We have got a high-speed dismount happening over on the start here for Pro-Am Runabout Box Stock. Justin Fardeen with the whole shot. Troy Snyder, second.
Got a yellow flag out, Don. There's a yellow flag out on the right side chicane, so those racers are going to have to get in file. They cannot pass on a yellow flag like that, as we had a dismount over on the right side chicane. Did you say that Dustin Fardeen pulled the whole shot in this one?
Troy Snyder, second. Tim Ducat in third. Troy Snyder actually pulling up last. It's Dykowski on the eight ball in second.
So I understand, Don, too, that as these riders work their way off the outside split section, that we just passed over half a million views today on the live stream. Dustin Fardeen down the front straightaway on the 116 boat on an Ackworth, Georgia run for Monster Energy, Sea-Doo, and Mountain Motorsports. I do believe that's Dykowski on the number eight boat, currently running second. And 149, Tim Ducat running third. So Fardeen, Dykowski, Ducat, running at your top three. And did you hear that? We just topped half a million views on the live stream as everything's happening here today at the Pro Watercross Tour in Atlantic City, New Jersey.
Man, I gotta tell you, Rick Ignacio is over there doing the happy dance.
I'll just sign it with that for now. I gotta get down. Go for it, no worries.
So I tell you what, Fardeen is really trying to stretch that lead out as he got on the inside split this time, trying to avoid maybe some traffic or get his way figured out on which split he likes best. So Fardeen ran the inside split, Dykowski running the inside split, but off the outside split, it's Tim Ducat, as Ducat trying to close that gap on Dykowski. Well, we had that rider get off on the right side split too. That rider is back on their boat up and racing again. I do think that might have been Brent Venderlay on the 404 boat, as he is down the front straightaway. Something doesn't quite seem right. Yeah, I do believe that's 404, Brent Venderlay down the front straightaway. As the front of the pack moving up on the back of the pack, Dustin Fardeen this time taking the outside split. So he's switching up the splits back and forth, maybe trying to figure out what he likes best.
Yeah. Working both of them just to see what the time is. He's got the opportunity to do it, and obviously some room.
Yeah, I think he likes being in front best.
Well, I mean, could safely say that for any racer. Pro-Am Ski Stock, you guys are going to be coming out of this gate next. Need to have you down the line. Pro-Am Ski Stock, down the line. Special thanks to Atlantic City for hosting the fifth round of the Pro Watercross National Tour, presented by Hidden Trails Motorsports Sea-Doo, and of course also presented by Jetlift. Back out on the track, Dustin Farthing continuing those winning ways.
Well, I think that's Brent Venderle out there on the back. He's got some sort of a boat issue because he's not going near as fast as everyone else. In fact, he's going out to pick up the equalizer buoy. So Farthing now on the outside split, your current leader. You've got Dykowski in second on the back straightaway. You've got Tim Ducat in third. And there's a lapper between Farthing and second and third.
I was just saying, I was double checking myself because Venderle was the one that was down over here, right? Yeah. He has the same boat, Ducat.
Yeah.
I thought it was Ducat at first, but it was Venderle. I'm kind of impressed. Yeah, Venderle getting a chiropractic adjusted on the right-hand side of the track, went off his boat, able to get back on that and move himself back into the race. But I know he's got a little catch-up to do, but just a shout-out for boat number 404. And I think you're right, he is definitely having some boat issues.
Yeah, he's having some boat issues. He came off over on that right-side chicane, might have taken on some water, but he was discombobulated, and he's much slower than the rest of the pack. I will note this, Don, that yesterday's EMTs are back with us, and today they're sporting beach attire, as they did promise they would come back as fans, and we did talk to them about putting them on some skis with some racers and get them out in the water. We will make sure that happens yet today. Dustin Farthing down the front straightaway, a whole half lap ahead of the second and third and fourth place contenders. So Farthing that much faster than the rest of the field today. A reminder, you are watching Pro-Am Runabout Box Stock, race number 14, which means race number 15, Pro-Am Ski Stock, should be working its way down toward the line.
And you must not be the only one watching Pro-Am Runabout Box Stock. Apparently a 500,000 of your closest friends are also checking in. Special thanks to Rick Ignacio at 24/7 streaming. .com, the gentleman that is doing his very best to make us world famous. Again, topping some numbers. I got to tell you, when you first threw out that number of 1 million views yesterday, I was like, okay, I hope we get there. That'd be cool. Now all of a sudden, I'm like, wow, that could really happen.
Well, if we're at 500,000 views today already, and we've got some show yet to go in the pro show, we've got people participating and playing along with us by becoming our friends at Pro Watercross on Facebook. It could happen, Don. We could get there.
All right. It looks like we are back streaming live. I do want to thank you guys for coming back and joining us after that quick 30-minute break as we did the amateur awards for everybody. And back out on this track, just to give you a quick update, it was really all about the Farthing show and this third moto for the Runabout Box Stock. Got the whole shot and just opened up the lead. But, man, again, just a monster acknowledgement to Jeff Dykowski on that eight ball machine. Got the whole shot on moto number two and had it for a couple of minutes. And then still holding up to that second place in moto number two. And that's going to put him in a nice position for the podium. But Dustin Farthing on his way for the top spot.
Yeah, Don, Dustin Farthing down the front straightaway. He is literally half to three quarters of a field in front of the rest of the pack. Jeff Dykowski, the number eight boat, currently running second. And then 149, Tim Ducat, wrapping it up in third. Farthing on that 116 boat out of Ackworth, Georgia, riding for his Monster Energy team, Sea-Doo, and Mountain Motorsports. Just a point or two to let folks know out there watching on live streaming. Dustin Farthing donating his winnings from the tour this year back to a not-for-profit in his own community in Ackworth, Georgia. What a swell guy. What an awesome racer. And he is kicking some tires, lighting some fires right here in Atlantic City, New Jersey.
Well, he's going to have the opportunity to give away even more because here's how the podium looks if it stays where it's at right now on the track. Looks like it is going to be Dustin Farthing at the top of this podium in second place with that 2-4 finish, but he's currently ahead of Troy Snyder. He's actually tied for points with Troy as Tim Ducat, and then Troy Snyder is going to round out that podium. So that's how it looks right now, but we still got a lot of racing left to go.
We do. I thought I saw the courtesy flags out last trip through, or maybe two trips ago. So we're a little more than halfway through this one. Dustin Farthing still, setting the pace that is just unbelievable on the back straightaway. Now he is lapping up. He's lapped fourth and fifth. I believe he's lapped up to like almost third place now, as that would be Tim Ducat.
I actually thought we were going to have cooler temperatures today after the rains, or just after the racing yesterday. We actually had a pretty good thunderstorm push through Atlantic City. Didn't last super long, but put down about, you know, an inch of accumulation. And I honestly thought we'd probably have a little bit of cooler temperatures. In fact, just the opposite has happened. Bright blue skies, just very scattered light clouds up above us. A little higher humidity today than yesterday, but we are definitely cooking in some higher degrees, and I'm wondering if that isn't going to have an impact as we move into these GP classes. You saw it earlier today. We had some attrition. I'm kind of thinking that could happen again, moto number three.
Yeah, it definitely could. I mean, in the one race, we actually finished with just two boats left as the attrition took its toll. The waves still playing a little bit of a factor here as the tide came in, the tide went down. It's still pretty high, yet now, yesterday, it was definitely bothersome for the racers as it went out. A difference in how much beach shows by about 150 feet, depending on whether it's high tide or low tide.
All right, just looking out over the track, and I am watching Dykowski get some pressure as Dustin Farthing continues to make his way through the pack. Brent Venderly moving over for him. Dustin Farthing aboard that big black 116 on the side of that boat. He just jumped onto the backstretch if you were looking for your race leader.
So you got Farthing coming right up on Ducat and Dykowski. Not quite sure what happened to Ducat, because Ducat was behind Dykowski, and now he's in front of him.
And he has a tendency to do that, Tim does. He's real sneaky that way. Whoa! Ducat and Slugger going at it. Ducat's got the line, but actually moved out of the way. It's going to be Slugger that takes over that third again. That was actually your battle for third. Little switcheroo. Farthing, Ducat, and Troy Snyder. That's what I said. Ducat in second.
Yeah, Ducat's in second, and that was Dykowski and Snyder going at it, like you said.
For a third. Mr. Costello making sure, keeping us honest up here in the tower. We love you, buddy. Appreciate the eyeballs. I think I was calling that right.
Yeah, you were calling it right, as Ducat had gotten by a lap earlier when we were doing the public service thing. So, no problem.
Love,
we got it right now.
Love Dan Costello helping us, though. I really appreciate that when these guys give us an extra set of eyeballs. All right, again, you are watching the action for Runabout Box Stock. Now, this is what Remar had talked about, and you know Mike Young, too. These are the boats that race on Sunday, and you run out to the dealership and buy on Monday. And the reason for that is because they're so much fun to ride. And I tell you, this is one of the funner classes to watch as well, because like the Pro-Am Ski Stock, this is all about the minor details. You got to really pay attention to what you're doing on the track. Really got to watch your lines, because you don't have that horsepower to save you. So, you know, if I fall a little bit behind, or I come in too tight into a turn and I spin out a little bit, I have to make that up in a slow roll versus being able to just grab a throttle in that GP class and quickly make your time up. So for me, the stock classes, Remar, are just all about these riders being really smooth and really calculating on the course.
Well, you know, it's like you said, too, you're dealing with limited horsepower. And so in a stock class, it's really kind of about how you set your boat up. How does it handle? How does it work together with you based on your height, based on your weight, based on the riding conditions, you know, prop, intake, great ride plate, steering? Those kinds of things make a big difference. You almost become maybe a little bit more one with your boat because you don't have the horsepower to set you up for the riding conditions.
I'll tell you what, a couple of tuners definitely know how to twist the wrenches right. Let's talk about Monster Energy, Sea-Doo, and the Mountain Motor Sports boat. And the gentleman underneath the hood is Beau Dupree, helping out Dustin Farthing on that gentleman that's under the white flag right now. In that second place, Tim Ducat also got a hot team working with him. That's Hidden Trails Motorsports, Sea-Doo, X-Team, and Jet Trim. And then, of course, Troy Snyder in third with the one and only Tim Judge, Judge Motorsports jet pilot, and Riva helping him out. And as they go onto the front stretch, it looks like only about 400 feet are going to keep him from a checkered flag. Put your hands together for Dustin Farthing.
Well, that's Dustin Farthing, you know, and he picked up the win in Moto 1, he picked up the win in Moto 2, and he picked up the win in Moto 3, so there's pretty much no doubt about it.
I'm going to call that a hat trick. All right, second place, Mr. Ducat. Third, going to be Troy Snyder. Dykowski jumping right back up on that front stretch, trying to get that pass back for third, and that was almost too close to call. I'm going to go ahead and give it to Snyder for now, and we'll let you know down after tech. Meanwhile, I need Pro-Am ski stock on the line, and all I see right now is really cool waves. Not that that isn't a neat view, but I need some skis. Oh my gosh.
Chefs in the house. Chefs in the house. Check these guys out rolling down off the boardwalk. Yeah. Chilling in the AC. Did you guys whip up something good today?
Oh yeah. I'm curious. First off, that you see the chefs come down here. That's pretty awesome. Secondly, I'm kind of like, did you bring any lunch?
Yeah, where's the food, man?
Because I got to imagine you're pretty awesome cooks. I'm just saying.
I caught Antoine out of that. Myron Brown, Josh Shoup, Charles Shoup, in the house. There we go, giving the chefs some love. as we prep for the next race of the day, down online, gonna be Pro-Am ski stock.
That was awesome. I mean, how often do you have the chefs come down and hang out with you? You guys are fantastic. Feel free to come up here and tell us who you are. When you're done,
it absolutely is the most fun I've ever had in Atlantic City.
I love that Landshark is right on the beach.
Margaritaville, everyone's having a great time.
I feel a lot younger.
Jimmy Buffett's Margaritaville, the Landshark Bar and Grill, the 5 o'clock somewhere bar.
I'll probably be there for the rest of the summer.
A new wave of entertainment is making a splash this summer at resorts.
Number 15, Pro-Am Ski Stock out of Hurricane Racing out of Apex, North Carolina on the 10 boat, Callaway Turner. On the Naples, Florida on the Monster Energy Mack Racing, Broward Racing boat, 13, Chris McLuggage. On the Miramar, Florida on the 51, David Cabrera. And we've got a rider down, David Cabrera, laying in the water on the start.
Well,
he didn't even make it past the first wave.
Yeah, tough break, sir. You got the hole shot a little bit earlier.
So this race is green flag. It is underway as course marshal Mike Ritt up in front right here keeping Cabrera safe. Cabrera back on his boat. He is still going to be able to start and get the start out of the way before the first rider comes by.
And Sam and the gang down there are like, what happened, man? Because last time we kicked you out of the gate, you had a hole shot. This time you were upside down and stuff. That ain't right.
I do believe Jimmy Wilson pulling the hole shot on the 300 boat. In second, Chris McLuggage on the 13. And is that Rick Shirker on the 912 currently running third done?
Yes, sir.
So Jimmy Wilson, man, that kid's been fast today. He's pulled some hole shots, and he just pulled the hole shot on this one again. Definitely got the got what's going on for the hole shot. McLuggage has his work cut out for him as he's going to have to try to chase down Jimmy Wilson again. So David Cabrera back up and running as he's going down that front straightaway. He's got to try to catch back up. He was over a half lap behind when he got back to his boat and was able to get going. Back to your leaders on the left side of the course over here by the steel pier. It's Wilson out in front on a 300 boat being chased by Chris McCluggage, and then Rick Shirker on the 912.
Isn't it interesting that both of those guys decided to go to the outside split? We had seen earlier that they had been working the inside split pretty consistently in order to try to make a pass. Jimmy, particularly in the interview, felt that it was a little bit faster, but I got to be thinking that while we were doing the amateur awards, somebody might have been out there adjusting some buoys, and being the pro racers that they were watching.
Well, off the right side chicane, and we saw this earlier in the Pro-Am stock race, or was it the other race? Wasn't stock, where McCluggage had missed the buoy and had the ward rail malfunction.
That was GP, yeah.
GP trying to chase down Jimmy Wilson, and in that one, they actually split motos. So Chris won Moto 1, Wilson won Moto 2. In this one, though, McCluggage has won both Motos 1 and 2 so far.
Yeah, and if you do the recap thinking back, it was actually Cabrera with the hole shot in the second moto that you and I were talking about with Broward Motorsports, so excited about it. But this time around, didn't get quite as good a start. Looked like he faced it just a little bit coming out of that start. Or got a connection happening, but it was about 1,000 yards out. Cabrera upside down and in that weird position of having to go swimming for a boat. Meanwhile, though, all about the Wilson-McCluggage show on the right-hand side of this track.
Yeah, Jimmy Wilson pulling that killer hole shot. Mac not getting off the line quite as well. And as they go through the right side chicane to the double yellows before that back straightaway, Jimmy Wilson really starting to stretch things out. Mac hard charging. There's some pretty big waves coming through the course right now. I don't know if you can see this, folks. Look at those rollers coming through the course right now. That is going to make things a tad bit more exciting.
Guy, you know what? I know what's going on here. That tide has shifted yet again and is starting to come back up. And I have all of us over on this right-hand side of the track noticed about the same time as we're watching these riders come through, these big rollers starting to become a real factor they're going to have to deal with. The good news to that is that the rollers are breaking at least a little bit out from that start gate, not the situation yesterday where they were literally breaking on the start gate, making the riding conditions that much more challenging. Right now, at least they got an opportunity to make a jump at it.
Yeah, literally yesterday, the waves were breaking right on the tops of the machines. And so it just made it that much tougher to get a good, clean start. This one now breaking inside of that front straightaway. But I'll tell you what, there's some rollers coming through now that are 3 and 4 feet as they come through the center of the course.
Yeah, run down right now, if you go from top five, we've got Jimmy Wilson. Then you've got Chris McCluggage, and then you have Rick Shirker, who went down briefly, still running up in third, got a solid race going, and Callaway Turner, and then David Cabrera. That's your top five right now as you watch your Pro-Am ski stock class. Not quite halfway through, I don't think, but let me give you the standings as they are. As Remar had talked earlier, McCluggage with a two aces in his hole as far as his hand that he's holding. He's only got one more to go to take this out. And then you've got Jimmy Wilson with a 2 for 2. So as you had talked about, this is really our tiebreaker, right? So if Wilson gets the win on this, actually still won't be enough. 5 and 3, 4. Nope, it'll still be Chris McCluggage. Wilson second, barring any crazy stuff, because you and I have always seen the crazy stuff too.
Well, here's the thing, Don. If Chris McCluggage stays where he is right now in second place, he'll finish with a 1, a 1, and a 2. You add that up, you get 4. Wilson will finish with 2 and 2 and 1. That's 5. But will McCluggage be willing to accept that, or will he go after Jimmy Wilson?
He's going to go after Jimmy anyway. We all know Mac Attack. Now, I will say then the battle really is David Cabrera. David had a 3rd in the first moto and a 4th in the second moto. Rick Shirker had a 4th in the first moto and a 3rd. In a second moto, Rick Shirker is currently ahead of David Cabrera after that kind of dismount that happened on the start.
So the battle for third place right there is really what's the hot contentious item here.
Yes, sir. You're watching Pro-Am Ski Stock right here on the Pro Watercross National Tour, brought to you by Hidden Trails Motorsports and Sea-Doo. I want to say a special thanks, by the way, to the city of Atlanta, Atlantic City, the city of Atlantic City. It's so hard to say that. I just keep messing that up. Let me just say it this way. Thank you so much, Atlantic City, New Jersey. And also special thanks to the Steel Pier. And also thanks to the Sport Commission for having us out here. And, man, it's been great this weekend. Also, special thanks to Resort Hotel and Casino, and that place is gorgeous.
It is gorgeous. I stayed there last night, and the night before, my room was incredible. Very, very happy with the venue. Very, very happy with the conditions, the turnout, the racing. Like I said, it just doesn't get any better than this.
You know, I got to say, I knew it would be fun to come and hang out on the Jersey beaches, but I didn't know it would be quite this much fun. And I got to honestly say, a lot of it for me and Remar has been how much fun the people have been. Super welcoming. You guys have done nothing but opened arms and been really generous and really participating all weekend long. Thank you so much for doing that. We really love it.
Speaking of good people, you got to check out over there at the Squatch place there. We've got Dane over there in the Jack Link Squatch booth. Feed the Beast. He's still passing out free Squatch. So if you haven't gotten any, you're down there in the beach area and you're thinking, man, I got a little rumble in my tummy. I need some Squatch. Come on down here and check out Dane.
You know, speaking of checking out Dane, I think Dane ought to start doing pro watercross. Just saying, I talked to him earlier. Guy is built. I think he needs to come race.
Sounds like somebody was checking out Dane.
No, I was not. I was talking about Squatch and Jack Links. Dane, don't you be blushing over there. But I do think you should come racing with us. Back out on the track, we have got a battle heating up for this third place spot between Shirker and Cabrera.
Yeah, like you said, Don, Rick Shirker picked up a fourth in Moto 1, a third in Moto 2, and then David Cabrera was third and fourth on the flip-flop. So the real battle here is for third place, because right now, if Chris McCluggage were to stay in second place where he is, he will actually win the overall event in the Pro-Am Ski Stock.
Yeah, I just saw Chris McCluggage just take a quick break and grab some relief from that lower back. That's one of the things that really tends to tighten up super fast in ski racing is that lower back. And the reason for that, you guys, if you watch them out there riding on the boats and then you think about motocross, right, like how they race motocross and the suspension in motocross actually takes a lot of the that pounding, right, that when you are landing or taking off and all of that crunch that's happening on your body. When you have suspension, at least it gets rid of some of it. There is no suspension on these boats. So what happens now is all of that energy's got to transfer somewhere. It's transferring right into their legs and right into their lower back. Forearms typically is another area that'll tighten up on them pretty quick, but definitely lower back. So oddly, and it seems weird, but oddly enough, one of the places that they can get relief from that is on a front stretch or a back stretch. Just take a little quick moment and get out of that attack position. Get a quick back stretch and then they're right back into it. That's what you saw McCluggage doing. I just got to point out, too, the gentleman on boat number 300, Jimmy Wilson, look how smooth he is on that stock ski. And as I had talked to you earlier, and Remar as well, smooth, quiet, finesse riding, keeping the boat hooked up. That is what is helping him maintain that lead. And as you see behind him, Chris McCluggage having a little bit tougher time because he's got a lot of whitewater he's got to deal with. Obviously, he's got to deal with some of the lapped riders as well.
Don, did you notice the big roller that just came through on the double yellow here, the second double yellow on the right side chicane? A big roller came through. Matt got big air as he went over that. And like you had said, the secret to winning in the Pro-Am stock ski class is to stay connected, be smooth, be fluid, don't scrub off the power. You got to maintain momentum. Matt caught some big air there. That cost him a little bit and might have given Jimmy Wilson a little bit more breathing room as they worked their way off the left side of the course. Jimmy Wilson looks back. He looked back to see where Mac was. And yet that is what happened as those rollers come through the front stretch. Yeah, they're huge. Those are 3, 4, 5 feet now. All right, Don says 5 or 6. So 5 or 6 foot rollers coming through on the front straightaway. Definitely making this course a little bit more brutal, especially as they go on the right side out to meet the back straightaway.
You know, and I'll tell you, somebody that knows all about how to deal with surf and big surf is none other than that French rider that we got to talk about for so many years, Nicholas Rias. I want to do a big shout out for him right now. I think he's actually listening in on the live stream. We love you, bud. Sorry we didn't get to see you racing this weekend, but man, I can't tell you how many times you had the entire fans and the crowd standing and waving and cheering you on. A great racer, Nicholas Rias. Thanks for watching. Also, our number one fan is in the house.
Who's our number one fan?
Nedra, we love you, baby girl. Thank you so much for watching and listening in on the live stream. And thank you for always being such a great part of Pro Watercross. We love you.
Definitely a shout out to Nicholas Rios. Frenchie, how you doing, man? Good to see you. Back to the racing action, though. Jimmy Wilson, white flag out, one lap to go. And they are working their way through the right side chicane. Chris McCluggage in second place. Now, McCluggage does not have to go after this. If he just maintains a second place finish in this third moto, he will finish with the overall victory, in which case Jimmy Wilson will finish second. The real race here, though, like Don had said, between Rick Shirker and David Cabrera.
Yeah, and how they finish now is how it's going to be on the podium. So that's really the big one under contention. You know, now that I'm thinking about this, Remar, I think probably McCluggage is playing a strategy game and a smart game. He's going to manage resources. He knows if he stays where he's at, he's got this podium locked. No reason to go up there and get mixed up.
Well, he went to the inside split. So Jimmy Wilson on the outside split. Jimmy Wilson doing the seventh inning stretch. McCluggage is going to try one hard time on the inside. Not going to be enough. Wilson has the momentum off the outside. Jimmy Wilson going to pick up the win in Moto 3 for the Pro-Am Ski Stock. But Chris McCluggage crossing the line in second in this moto, going to take the overall win. Give it up, folks, for Chris McCluggage, your Pro-Am Ski Stock winner right here in Atlantic City, New Jersey, over the fifth round of the Pro Watercross National Tour.
All right, so I'm going to call this as an unofficial, but Shirker finishing up his lap. I do believe that's going to be your third place. And then it is going to be Turner and then Cabrera, your top five. Might have been Cabrera in fourth, but I'll let Tech and Scoring finalize that. Meanwhile, what's our next race up, sir?
Well, down online, we should have Sport GP. Sport GP, race number 16 of the day, should be down online. I hear those sport boats over there. Look at those guys getting air as they leave the pit area to go out to the race course and warm up. Big air. There are some pretty good-sized rollers coming through here right now. Like Don said, 5 and 6 feet just rolling through the entire course as we're in Atlantic City right next to the famous Steel Pier. Well, next class of the day coming down towards the line, Sport GP, race number 16. Once again, thanking everybody that's reaching out to us, thanking all the selfies that came in. If you took a selfie of yourself and you went to our website, you went to Pro Watercross on Facebook, and you friended us and you sent us that selfie, we're going to be giving away some t-shirts. We're looking for the best male, the best female selfie to come through. We have tapped over a half a million views today on the live stream. And Rick making that happen, half million. We're looking for the next number at 600,000, then 700,000. We believe that with your help, we could get to 1 million views.
That almost made me want to break out in song. I'm not going to, though. Guys, I do want to also ask you, if you've got GoPro footage, don't forget to run it up here to the guys at Long Haul Productions, Rodney Hoffman and Brody. And we can grab that footage from you really quick. Dylan Osborne, shout out for you, buddy. Thanks for doing that for us. He's been consistently bringing us up here every tour race. We really love it. So we are using that in our TV shows and really appreciate that. So if you've got GoPro footage, bring it on up here. Rodney will take it from you.
That is awesome. Well, Don, we're getting ready to kick off the Sport GP. You want to do the rundown? Let's do the lineup and see who's online for this third moto.
Who's on first?
Who's on first? What's on second? I don't know who's on third.
You go first.
All right. Well, down online, picking up the second moto, second place finish out of Team Faith, Fly Racing WPS, Pirelli KTM, Jetlift, Pro Watercraft Racing out of Ludington, Michigan. A Michigan boy. Number one, Kelly Smith.
He comes from Cooper City, Florida. Took two firsts in Moto 1 and Moto 2. He's sponsored by Broward Motorsports, Judge Motorsports, Exotic Signs, Shoei, Jet Pilot, Wamilton's, ISAW, Jet Lift, and Thrust Innovations. Boat number 13, Sam Nemi.
Out of Naples, Florida, riding on the HPE Amsoil, Scott Goggles, Yamaha 18, Sean Reynolds.
And out of Mims, Florida, sponsored by Trinity, Jet Pilot, HydroTurf, Novi, KC, Whitetails, 72 at Johnny Smith, and holy hole shots. Man, that wiped out a ton.
Wow. Johnny Smith, Sean Reynolds laying in the water on the 18 boat.
Yeah, and boat number 13, Sam Nemi got faced off of one of those as well and is going to have to play catch up. And that is going to make this a whole new ballgame. Kelly Smith with the whole shot. And it's going to be Johnny Smith that's going to the inside.
You are so right, Don, that we lost two machines right away on the start. And Sam Nemi, who's won basically everything he's been in, like you said, he's got a 1-1 finish in Moto 1 and Moto 2, but he's certainly finding himself in third place as they come down front straightaway. Kelly Smith, your leader. Johnny Smith in second, and there's Sam Nemi on the 13 boat in third.
Wow, I am astounded. You know what's going to be interesting? This is going to make this an awesome race.
Oh, Kelly Smith rolls it over on the far right side chicane. So Smith rolls it over, Kelly that is. That puts Johnny Smith out in front now on the 72 machine with Sam Nemi knock, knock, knocking on his door. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, Don. I just got excited.
No comment. I tell you, interesting. We've been talking about the rollers, and already the rollers are starting to have a major impact. Sam Nemi, one of the victims of that, just trying to come out of that gate.
So Sam Nemi going to run the inside split as Johnny Smith goes to the outside. So we'll see how that comes together. They come down the front straightaway. Johnny Smith on the 72 boat actually came out of the racing situation pretty much unscathed.
Now, why is it that I have two number 13 boats is my question. So is Johnny Smith on borrowed property?
Well, I do believe after getting back on his boat, Kelly Smith is now in fourth place. Johnny Smith, who got out there real fast and was leading, but I think Sam Nemi's already made the pass. Hasn't Sam made that pass already?
Not yet.
Don Dawson going to go mobile, give us a little bit better view as they go out there and down the front straightaway. So Sam Nemi has taken over the lead. Sam Nemi out in front as Johnny Smith on a 72 boat currently running third. Kelly Smith on the one boat currently running third place. And then here comes Sean Reynolds on the 18 who dismounted on the start. These rollers have really started to pick up their pace. The faces of these things now are 5 and 6 feet. And you know what, a blaster, they just got crazy and sideways anyways. Looked like they were doing some sort of a freestyle routine. But Sam Nemi, who won motor number one and motor number two, has taken back over the lead. He's working his way through the outside split section on the left side. 72, Johnny Smith trying to hold on to that second position, has gone inside, and then Kelly Smith on a number one boat, currently on the outside split section.
You know what, Remar, I really do, hands down, gotta just give a huge acknowledgement and props to Broward Motorsports. So I had a suspicion that that's what had happened, and I started talking about it, but then I'm like, well, but I'm not sure who's on first here, because we got two 13 boats, but I knew at least one of those boats was borrowed property. Sure enough, I'm down here with you, you're just gorgeous. This is Sam Nemi's wife, of course, and tell me a little bit about what happened, but Johnny Smith broke, and you loaned him a boat.
In the last race, I guess it was the last GP race, Johnny Smith's boat broke and Sam offered his spec boat to him so he wouldn't miss out on this race.
Okay, but let's talk about that start. So Sam, I know Sam probably doesn't ever want to
I don't know what the heck happened in that start, but Sam went sideways in the air and stayed on it, saved it, and worked his way back up to first.
Okay, so here's the deal. He scarecrowed it. They actually would call that a trick. You know that.
I don't know if it's a yard sale. I don't know what everyone calls it.
No. A yard sale would be if he totally lost it.
Okay. Well, he stayed on it, so I guess that's a scarecrow.
Oh, my gosh. She's as excited as we are. Can you tell? Thank you so much.
Thank you guys. It's a great race. Both GP races have been exciting, and he's fighting for everything out there, and we're just really proud of him.
Yeah, well, I tell you what, we're really proud of him, and we're really, really grateful to have you here, too, and it's awesome that you let Johnny borrow a boat.
Oh, yeah, anytime, but thank you guys for putting these races on. It's amazing to come out here and watch my son and my husband race. So.
Who, by the way, are awesome. I guess my only other question is, why aren't you suited up?
No, you do not want to. I would be the one yard sailing out there. You don't want to see me out there.
That's not true. I actually do.
I'll go out there and have fun, but not racing, no. Thank you.
All right, Remar, back to you.
So in the meantime, Don, we have had Sam Nimi move up to that first position, but Kelly Smith has taken over second from Johnny Smith, who was riding on the OPP. So down the front straightaway, you've got Sam Nimi, your current leader, and now here comes Kelly Smith, last year's national champion, trying to hunt him down on that Sea-Doo. And then the change with Johnny Smith moving back into the third position. Once again, you are watching race number 16, Sport GP, which means we need to have race number 17 working its way down towards the line. Race 17, Pro-Am Runabout GP. Those boats should be in the water working their way down towards the line for the start of their race.
He's on the white. Wow. Okay, well, I'm glad we got the recap on that. But, yeah, it was definitely Sam Nimi doing the, well, let's just call it the one-legged monkey jump start. Because it certainly took everything he had to hold on to it. He literally launched off of a four-foot wave sideways, only thing holding on one hand, and managed to save it. Put him in third, from third to first, and now Kelly Smith back up in second, and I've got to wonder what's going on underneath the helmet with Kelly Smith, because honestly, Remar, he had that. He just needed to get some distance, and he had one falter, and I tell you what, these big rollers off of these buoys are just really causing some havoc. Certainly created a problem for Smith. He went just a little sideways on that right-hand side of the track on the final buoy before the back stretch, and that was all it took for a Sam Nimi, gentleman that's just been unstoppable, to get back up in the lead, and that's how it looks right now for Sport GP.
Well, you know, it's interesting enough, too, because, you know, Kelly Smith, like you said, he pulled the hole shot. He was out in front by quite a bit. He made that right side chicane, and just as he was cutting back towards the inside of the track, a face of a wave caught him, and it flipped him over just enough. He got high-sided, is what they call it. And then, you know, he's back on his machine. He's had to battle his way back through the pack. And I got to believe that, based on what I'm seeing in front of my eyes, he is closing the gap on Sam Nimi.
Well, and I again, for those of you that have joined us on these national tour rounds, if you remember, in Panama City Beach, our very first stop, we had an indication even then when we had all of those back and forth lead changes between Kelly Smith and Sam Nimi in those first two motos. Everybody's nodding because they remember that. It was some of the most fun racing that we've watched, and that actually started off the tour, and that pretty much laid the groundwork for how this Sport GP class was going to look all year, and it has been a royal smackdown.
Well, Sam Nimi must have heard me when I just said that Kelly Smith was closing the gap, because just over that last half a lap and on that back straightaway, he really opened it back up. Maybe he was taking a little breather there for a second. That tends to happen. You take the little seventh inning stretch in the middle of the race, because Sam Nimi is now an entire front straightaway again ahead of Kelly Smith. A reminder that you are currently watching race number 16, Sport GP. We need to have race number 17 down online, Pro-Am Runabout GP. Pro-Am Runabout GP should be working its way down towards the line.
Minute motos, and it's got to feel like 20 minute motos when you are dealing with a 6 foot swell coming at you and you're trying to make a double turn. Hey, Ashley, Ashley Neamy. Ashley. I just want to tell her thank you so much for giving us the update on the Sport GP. She is so focused on the racing, though, she didn't even hear me.
So Sam Neamy, down the front straightaway, you can definitely hear that machine bark as this is Sport GP. And real quick, I'm just going to take a quick second. Carson, what kind of motor do they drop in that Sport GP now? It's obviously not the 701 that it came with back in the day.
Most of them run on the triple.
They're running a triple, so it's an 1100 triple, and they drop it into the sport boat. Now, does that take a lot of work? Do they have to do a lot of cutting to be able to make that happen and fit that in?
Well, they got custom hulls now, unlike the regular ones. They've actually opened up the container on that. And I'm sorry, I can't see. Looks like it's actually Johnny Smith down over on the left-hand side of the track on the outside.
Course Marshall's heading over there. Yeah, he's down right at the end of the last buoy on the outside split. He is back on his machine up and running before he needed Course Marshall's. But, yeah, that was Johnny Smith laying in the water.
No, he didn't. He was back up that quick. I love watching Johnny Smith ride. I got to say, too, a big shout-out to Drake and Mike Root, by the way. Both those Course Marshals, very quick to respond to the riders the entire weekend. Really appreciate having them out on the course, taking care of the guys. Because, man, we definitely need good Course Marshals, and we've got some of the best in the business right here on the Pro Watercross National Tour.
Well, things shake out the way they are right now. Sam Neamy obviously won moto number one, and he won moto number two on his Broward Motorsports, Judge Motorsports, Exotic Sign, Shoei, Jet Pilot, Wimbledon's, Isaw, Jet Lift, Thrust Innovation sponsored machine. So if he stays where he is, he's obviously going to get the overall victory. Kelly Smith, who was second in moto one and second in moto two, would be second. And then I guess what would happen is Sean Reynolds was third and fourth, and Johnny Smith was fourth and third, so Johnny Smith is currently running third. He would be our third-place finisher.
Well, you're going to have another battle for third, but here's the deal. Sean Reynolds was one of the riders that went off on that start, so he's actually a lap down. So making that kind of an easy run for Johnny Smith if Johnny Smith does not go off this boat on this final lap. As you know, he had a little bit of issues off that outside split on the lap prior. So white flag is out. As they say, it's the hallelujah flag. One more to go.
Hallelujah. I remember when I raced, I used to look for that flag. And it's funny because you'd be coming down the front straightaway, you'd look at the flagman, and the flagman knew what you wanted to see. He'd just shake his head, no, not yet.
Yeah, I remember that guy. It was Blake Corning. He used to just taunt us. Nope. Nope. Nope, and you need to go get on the VersaClimb or quit looking. Man, I want to say a special thanks to Visit West Virginia. Guys are so awesome. Thanks for supporting the live stream. We're going to be in your hometown in just a couple of weeks. That's going to be our final tour stop and the national championship for Charleston, West Virginia. Meanwhile, talking about the final stop, there it is for Sam Neamy, and that is going to firmly place him at the top of the podium at Sport GP today.
There you have it, Atlantic City. Give it up for your winner of Sport GP, Sam Neamy, out of Cooper City, Florida. Sam Neamy taking home the Moto 1 win, the Moto 2 win, and the Moto 3 win. No doubt about who won that class.
And it is going to be Kelly Smith second. And then Johnny Smith in third. And that's going to turn it over to Pro-Am Runabout GP. I need to have you guys on the line. Pro-Am Runabout GP.
Wow, did you see that wave hit Juan Rata down there on the end? Juan Rata was trying to move some boats, and that wave just smashed over the front of his machine, almost took him off the machine. This is getting to be some slicing and some dicing racing. We've got boats down. We've got a boat still down out on the course from that last race with the Sport GP.
thank you for watching Pro Watercross.
Better. Pro-Am Runabout GP. He's out of Catawba, North Carolina. Had a first place and a second place finish sponsored by Factory Yamaha, Fly, Jet, Lift, Champion Power Sports, and Dean's team. Boat number five, the Tweaker in the house, Brian Baldwin.
We got Hidden Trails Motorsports, Black Star DEI, Jet Drive Riva. Out of Charleston, West Virginia, 21X, Cameron Frame.
And out of Charleston, West Virginia, sponsored by Hidden Trails Motorsports, Black Star, Jet Drive Riva, Engine Tech, Superchargers, Trey Frame. I'm curious that we are announcing a lot of riders, and there are three.
Well, that's what I'm saying. We've got six riders in this class. I only see three boats out there.
Brian Baldwin's one of them, and he's working a hole shot.
I didn't see Farthing. Is Farthing out there?
Yep, second.
He's in second. Okay, there's Farthing. So we've got Baldwin in first, Farthing in second, and who's the third machine? Tim Duquette?
I almost announced Dylan Osborne, but then I noticed he's chilling like a villain up here with me. Dylan? Did you break your boat?
Yeah.
So Brian Baldwin pulling the hole shot down the front straightaway out of Catawba, North Carolina. He's being followed by Dustin Farthing on the 116 boat, and then 149, Tim Duquette, running out our field of three racers in the Pro-Am Runabout GP. Now, earlier, if you remember, we were watching this class. A number of boats did not finish because of the attrition. They blew up or they had issues. That's why we have so few boats on the line this time, Don.
Speaking of attrition, not issues, but attrition, someone that I know that had an out-of-body experience, Dylan Osborne, describe what it's like on this course. It looks pretty brutal.
Yeah, this course, the water changes like every lap. That backstretch, 1 minute you get rollers, the next minute it's chop, and then sometimes you just have calm water and you go for it. It's just, it's constantly changing. And on the front stretch, the waves are actually coming sideways almost. It's really, you gotta pay attention.
And I gotta say, and from our perspective anyway, the probably most challenging buoy has been this far right-hand side buoy off of that front stretch. Your perspective?
Yeah, I almost got myself in trouble a couple times there. That one and then the one going into the splits, it'll bite you if you're not paying attention.
Yeah, I noticed. And a couple of, even on the big boats, I noticed it kind of facing into you pretty hard, and that's because of the off-camber setup.
Yep. Yeah, the way the waves are, if you don't realize that the wave's right there or whatnot, it'll dance you around a little bit, and it kind of wants to eject you sometimes.
Well, unfortunately, we didn't get a chance to watch you in this final moto out on the track because you are awesome. Gentleman, by the way, who just moved up into pros a couple of years ago. So cool to see you racing with the pros, but what happened? You have a boat break? Or?
Yeah, I came in from box stock. I ran a decent box stock race, and then come in last lap, and it's just not running right here. It's puking oil out of the back, so.
Yeah, better to get that back on the trailer than to risk blowing it up even worse.
Yep, you got to prepare for the next round, so.
Deal. All right. Well, we will see you in Hartwell, Georgia. Meanwhile, you can hang up here and watch the race. Back to you, sir.
Dustin Farthing having made that pass on Brian Baldwin a lap or two ago. And so now Farthing is out in front with Baldwin chasing. Farthing riding his Monster Energy Sea-Doo Mountain Motorsports machine. Brian Baldwin on the factory Yamaha Fly Jet Lift Champion Power Sports Dean's Team machine. Yesterday, we were talking to Brian Baldwin, and he was showing off his arms. He said, these are some Yamaha arms. And that was pretty funny because now when you look at them out there, you got Dustin Farthing on a Sea-Doo, Brian Baldwin on a Yamaha. So the manufacturer is being represented by their stud runners.
Well, and I tell you, both got a pretty powerful set of guns. We take down and watch just the racing history of those two riders. Good Lord, it's 17 world titles for Dustin Farthing, 5 world titles for Brian Baldwin. I think 3 national titles for Brian Baldwin. And I'm untold amount of number of national titles for Dustin Farthing. So yeah, I would say you got some pretty heavily packed talent down there on those top two. Then you click it back into that third spot, and Tim Duquette, who has also had his fair share on both podiums, national and world. This year in particular, this sponsor, Hidden Trails Motorsports, I don't know, it just feels like he's gone up to the next level.
Yeah, I'd have to say that he has, and you know, I remember seeing him ride back in the day when he first came on the tour, and I do not remember him being like this.
I mean, I don't either.
He's sick fast.
And he's always been fast, don't get me wrong, but I mean, it's just, he's aggressive in a smart way. Actually, you know what, I'm going to go ask an expert, because Dylan has been racing with him, so I'm going to tap into the expertise over here with Dylan. Dylan, do you feel like Tim Duquette's been faster this year?
Yeah, he is fast. He, surf racing, he was real slow, but I mean, he's getting really onto it. I mean, he's got on that good Sea-Doo. I mean, you can't complain about that Sea-Doo. It just carves right around, and once he learned that new Sea-Doo, I practiced with him a couple times, and every time he goes out there for laps, he's better and better. I mean, he's just learning how to work that Sea-Doo. I mean, you just hang on to that Sea-Doo, and it'll take you to the win.
Yeah, I don't think it's quite that easy, because I could hang on to the Sea-Doo, and that would take me exactly nowhere, except for a cool ride.
Yeah, well, you got to hang on to it and grab the throttle, too.
Okay. I figured there's a couple more spots to that. Dylan, thanks again, bud.
Farthing trying to stretch that lead out. He just can't seem to shake Brian Baldwin as the front of the pack moving up on the back of the pack. So Tim Ducat, who's actually, we were just talking about, is quite a fast racer, is looking at Dustin Farthing sneaking up behind him. So Dustin Farthing, your current first place rider, closing in on the third place rider, and Brian Baldwin, who's in second, trying to catch up to Farthing and just hold his own. So inside split section for Ducat and inside split section for Farthing as well. So Farthing choosing to follow that rider that he's attempting to lap. And that might be some mind play. Maybe he's trying to get in his head a little bit and let him know I'm chasing you on the same split.
Man, I tell you what, the action this weekend on the Hidden Trails Motorsports Sea-Doo Pro Watercross National Tour has been stellar. And this class, even though we have three riders, has also been stellar. So much fun to watch Brian Baldwin and check the backstretch.
That's Farthing coming up on Ducat, just like I said, front of the pack moving up on the back of the pack. And Farthing going by Ducat. Farthing going to go to the inside split. Ducat going to go to the outside. Farthing pretty much already made the pass on the back straightaway. Man, that boat is fast.
Yeah, I think Ducat just wanted to kind of open up the throttle and see just how fast that boat was. Still kept the line open, though, for Dustin Farthing, as was appropriate and typical of Tim Ducat, as a great racer and a good ambassador.
Yeah, I think you're right. I would have kind of wanted to know, too. Hey, what's my boat got?
Oh.
How can I run with Farthing's boat here? I just got to see. But you're right. He did leave the line open, which is very good racing style.
You know, it's just one of those rare moments when you go, I wonder how fast my boat is.
And then you find out you don't really like the answer.
Right. I didn't really like that answer. Although, they looked really fast. Both of them very compatible. Again, you're watching Dustin Farthing as we count down the lap. For the Hidden Trails Sea-Doo Pro Watercross National Tour, you're watching Pro Runabout GP. By the way, this is our premier class for the sit-downs. And I think, really, Remar put it perfectly. Yamaha versus Sea-Doo, and right now Sea-Doo, as has been their habit, is on the top.
Yeah, I like to see the battle of the manufacturers, because you know, that's what got a lot of this stuff started way back in the day when Kawasaki was making their jet skis, and then the rest of the manufacturers joined in. And these days, this is what you have going on. Some really big machines that are incredibly fast, and some skis as well, along with some retro machines in the sport class. It just makes for some quality racing. Farthing on the back straightaway. Brian Baldwin trying to close that door, but nothing happened with that. And then Ducat now trying to race with Baldwin as well.
All right, Remar, man, again, I want to just thank you so much for being a part of it this weekend, round number 5. Also, shout out to Rick Ignacio. We still got some great racing at you, but I just got to do a huge props to the 500-plus views, and I mean 500,000-plus views we've gotten this weekend. And just today, great job, Rick Ignacio, 24/7 streaming live. And, of course, props to Long Haul Productions, and if you want to watch these TV shows, just go to prowatercross.com, and they will get you hooked up with all the airtimes. And again, massive shout out to the Moon Man and Trey Frame, our buddies down there at Hidden Trails Motorsports. Not only are they awesome sponsors and our title sponsors, but they are also pretty darn incredible racers.
Yeah, those guys are just the nicest guys. I remember way back in the day when they first came on the tour. And they were coming to Region 6 stuff, and they were carrying this West Virginia flag that they'd always be sporting with them. They're like, who are these guys?
I know, and they were
bunch
just as jokers. Rowdy.
Yeah, they were pretty rowdy. Now they're like seasoned veterans, hardcore racers, great sponsors, great businessmen, just good people.
Well, make no mistake, they're still rowdy. I mean, you know, I'm just saying. But I did not know that Trey Frame used to race stand-up. Now, I thought that was actually really cool. All right, again, Dustin Farthing, you're making this look way too easy. The gentleman that's sponsored by Monster Energy. Also sponsored by Sea-Doo Mountain Motorsports. Mountain Motorsports, of course, he's partners with this group. and out of Ackworth, Georgia. And talking about the GP class, it looks like Ducat actually, once again, the same spot even. He was having issues once before, and right now he's having issues over on the left-hand side of the track. If you look towards that outside final buoy, and he's got his hand in the air like, man, I got something going on here.
Yeah, you're right. That is the same spot as earlier. And we remember in this race earlier in Moto 2, we had some attrition. We had a number of boats that did not finish. You're talking about Pro-Am runabout GPs. These boats make a ton of horsepower. There's almost unlimited rules as to what they can do to get them to go. And these guys push that boundary. They push the envelope every time they sit down with their mechanics and figure out how do we get more out of these boats.
Okay, well, good news, bad news. Here's the bad news. He's going to have to finish the race early as they do a quick look under the hood, and I'm sure it won't take very much with those guys because those boats are amazing. That's the bad news. The good news is, though, there were only three people because of that attrition, so he doesn't lose a spot, which is pretty critical right now, especially on that final moto. So it's really not going to hurt Tim Ducat. Honestly, I think he probably was also playing strategy knowing him. He's like, you know what? Boat's not feeling quite right. I'm just going to bring her in. Just going to bring her in. I don't want to hurt it. This boat has been awesome for them all year. Tim Ducat going to retire a little bit earlier, does not lose his place on the course. Meanwhile, still on the course for this 12-minute moto, the one and only King D in the house, dominating. And then we've got the tweaker, Brian Baldwin, in second place. Meanwhile, David Redinger getting down there and ready for some strategy. By the way, Dustin Motzuris was on the phone earlier because I called him. Because I'm a stalker like that. And he wanted to tell me to wish you very good luck and was telling you how awesome you're doing. All right, back to you, Mr. Remar.
Well, we are watching Dustin Farthing coming off the outside split section down the front straightaway. We did lose Ducat, so now it's just Farthing and Baldwin. Brian Baldwin on the Yamaha, Dustin Farthing on the Sea-Doo. And you're right, Don, that Monster Energy Sea-Doo Mountain Motorsports machine that Farthing's on is absolutely flying. He's looking fast. Kelly Smith, what was up with that little issue over on the right side chicane there, man? A little high side action going on there or what? You made a nice comeback, though. Those waves all of a sudden got really big right in the middle at the beginning and all through your race. That was crazy.
Yeah, I really got to hand it to Dustin. I was watching him on the right-hand side again. We're kind of looking at these rollers coming in, and for some reason, I think Dylan really spoke it best. That course is set up just a little bit off camber to the waves, and so when they're making some of these turns, watch on this white flag, this last lap for Dustin, kind of just watch him come into this. He actually faced off of a couple of these and, like, launched sideways. And he's going to crank it down just a little bit. I noticed he just kind of worked his way over and rolled over that final turn off that double yellow. But that's where he caught massive air on the lap right before.
This right side chicane on this course, you're right. It's off camber to the way the angle of the course, to the way the waves are coming in. It's causing some problems. That's where we've seen most of our crashes, most of our get-offs, and most of our rubbing being racing.
Yep, that Shark Energy update, by the way, brought to you by Mike Remar and Don Dawson up here in the announcer tower of power, hanging out with all the cool people in Atlantic City. And I want to just say thank you so much to your city for being our host for the fifth round of the Hidden Trails Sea-Doo Pro Watercross National Tour presented by Jet Left. And you guys have just been wonderful hosts. And I tell you what, Dustin Farthing loves you too. Why?
Because he just won that race with the checkered flag as he was kicking some tires, lighting some fires. Dustin Farthing picked up a second place in Moto 1 and a first place in Moto 2 and a first place in Moto 3, whereas Brian Baldwin won Moto 1, second in Moto 2, and he'll be second in Moto 3. So Dustin Farthing, your winner of Pro-Am Runabout GP here in Atlantic City for the fifth round of the Pro Watercross National Tour. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Dustin Farthing!
Man, I gotta tell you, here's how the podium is gonna look for that GP class. That Hidden Trails Sea-Doo GP class goes like this. Dustin Farthing at the top of the heap aboard that awesome Sea-Doo that he has been rocking all year. In second place is gonna be the tweaker, Brian Baldwin, and Tim Ducat gonna round out that field. By the way, the same guy that's riding for Hidden Trails Motorsports. That's how the GP class looked. Don't you go anywhere though. We still got Pro Ski GP coming next.
Pro Ski GP, baby. That's what I'm talking about. Just to give you the breakdown of these machines. These are stand-up watercross. These are pro racers. And GP pretty much means it's like a Grand Prix. They can do anything they want inside, make as much horsepower as they want, make modifications to the hulls as they want. And these guys are sick fast. You're going to want to check out this motor number 3 of Pro-Am Ski GP.
Ski GP could be coming at you next. We'll do the rundown in just a minute, but quick recap for you, because it got a little insane, right? I guess probably two of the biggest things, you got to really do a big shout out for Redinger. Pop that hole shot. What is it that you always say, like a hot knife through butter? That's how it looked too, man. He just skedaddled out of there. Anyway, so Redinger with the hole shot. It was Jimmy Wilson coming from that inside split, working that second place spot. And then Jimmy Wilson basically had just been working him and made a pass from the inside, moving Jimmy Wilson into the lead. Meanwhile, you had Chris McCluggage coming up, and Chris McCluggage had a wardrobe adjustment, if you will. But let me just tell you what really happened, right? So it's hot out here. We got a lot of humidity, and it is hot. And so he was racing with a wetsuit, which I totally get that, right? Because you want to protect your knees, because they are bouncing all over the place on those skis. So he had the wetsuit, but he only had it halfway on the like Farmer John's, what we call them. And he had it halfway up. Well, what happened was one of the waves sucked it down, yanked it just enough that it was a problem. He had to get down into the tray, take a quick break, adjust the wetsuit, and then come back. And from there, right back up. Into second.
Yeah, and it was funny too, Don, because when I did the interview with Mac Attack earlier, he actually called it the crack attack.
No way.
He did. He called it the crack attack when he described his own wardrobe malfunction.
Oh my gosh. All right, well, here's your rundown. Out of Yakima, Washington, sponsored by Commander, RM, Fly, Blowsion, Villain, Jet Trim, Rhino Power, 360 Flights, Boat Number 3, David Redinger.
And out of Liberty Lake, Washington, riding on the Commander team on 24, Derek Helm.
Out of Naples, Florida, it is the Mac Attack, sponsored by Monster Energy, Mac Racing, Broward Motorsports, Jet Trim, Jet Pilot, Jet Lift, ADA, and Liquid Militia.
And out of Broward Motorsports, Team Mean Racing, Wet Sport Racing, Exotic Signs, and Wambletons, 51, David Cabrera.
And out of West Harrison, Indiana, sponsored by Factory Yamaha, ETS Racing Fuel, Jet Renew, IPD, Graphics, ADA Racing, Hydroturf, and Fly Racing, it is boat number 94, Josh Block.
Out of Apex, North Carolina, run for Hurricane Performance, Amsoil, Advent Ignitions, Imagination Fabrication, on 106, Bill Hegg.
And also in that field, Jimmy Wilson, Mike Kelberer, and Rick Shirker. And ladies and gentlemen, this is our final race of the day, and the fastest skis of the day. Stand up for our final one, and it is going to be Chris McCluggage, the Mac Attack, with a hole shot on the outside split. Can he lock it down?
Well, we talked about that earlier because Jimmy Wilson was able to just hold him off as Mac missed that buoy, had to go pick up the equalizer buoy. And I predicted that Mac would come back with a fury, and he has. So Chris McCluggage down the front straightaway, your current leader. He's being hounded by Jimmy Wilson on the 300 boat.
Yeah, so here's our rundown. You've got the Mac Attack, Wilson. Then you've got Redinger. Then you've got Derek Helm in your top four.
So there you have it. McCluggage pulling the hole shot this time. And we were talking earlier, Don, about how fast Jimmy Wilson's been with his hole shots, as he pulled quite a few hole shots in the last couple of days. But McCluggage was all over at that time. I mean, he was just on it and checked out and gone. Look at the gap that he has over Wilson on the back straightaway, a half a straightaway long.
Yeah, I'm going to say something about Chris and Jimmy both, right? So both of these guys, they're coming into this final moto. This is where all the cards are laying down. And you guys, get loud, get proud, because it's going to be our final moto of the final race of the day. But these guys knew, I got to punch the clock and I got to get to work. Chris McCluggage wasted no time coming out of that start, and he popped a hole shot like nobody's business. But Jimmy Wilson, the gentleman, it's about 10 seconds off that pace. Got to put the pressure on. Meanwhile, Derek Helm pushing for that third place spot. David Rediger, fourth. And it looks like Shirker in fifth.
Look at the waves they're catching as they work their way over to the right chicane. Those guys handled that like true pros, because that's what they are. All of them were catching air and making the turn in the air, almost like a 180 nose stab as they came down to go through that right side chicane. Not one of them fell, and that was a tough maneuver.
It's Mike Kilmer up in a sixth place spot. Gentleman that we just gave an award to in the amateur racing as well. Again, left-hand side of the track, it's McCluggage, the Mac Attack.
Going on the outside split section, it is McCluggage down the front straightaway. And once again, Jimmy Wilson in second. Now, Derek Helm was in third, but I do believe that a pass was made. No, Derek Helm's still there.
I don't know about that. Let's see. It's Rediger making a push on him from that inside split. Yep, on this one. He actually had gotten around, and then I think he dropped down on his tray, and that actually might have caught Rediger a spot temporarily. That is Shirker right behind Hellman, fourth, and it's going to be Rediger back in fifth. What's going on here? The gentleman that got the hole shot in the moto earlier having to come in, there's something going on with the boat, because he did pass Derek Helm for that third place spot. Now Rediger having to come in. That is a tough break for this young man that just got married last week.
Yeah, so Rediger, who, like you said, did pull the hole shot in the second moto earlier today, looked really good. Just raced his machine up on shore, and it does not look like a happy camper. Looks like Rediger done for the day in moto number three. And that's going to cost him, because so far he had a third place in moto one, third place in moto two, and now a DNF in moto three.
Yeah, and I tell you, one of the most improved riders we've seen in the last 2 years, a gentleman that pulled the hole shot in that second moto, and now in the awkward and unfortunate position of hanging out on the beach. Really tough break for David Rediger. Meanwhile, though, back out on this track, it is all about the Mac Attack and Jimmy Wilson. And to tell you what, if there's any guy that can run down Chris McCluggage, it's going to be Jimmy Wilson, gentleman that also just had a baby. He's a firefighter in his regular work day. But on the weekend, he likes to come out and hang out at the Hidden Trails CD Pro Watercross National Tour. And when he comes to hang out, he typically likes to hang out on the podium.
Well, you know, I know a lot of firemen, too. And I think part of what it takes to be a professional fireman these days is being in shape. And I think some of the time those guys are actually on the clock to get paid to work out. So that's got to be helpful when you transition, if you were going to transition from one career to another.
I was just watching Chris McCluggage work his way through that front stretch. And again, got this course set up just a smidge off camber from how the waves are breaking in. And you're watching both Jimmy Wilson and McCluggage treating that with a lot of respect on that front stretch. Really watching where they want to work their way over those rollers. Particularly this right-hand side of the track looks pretty technical to me. Battle happening with Helm and Shirker. That is Derek Helm on that black and yellow boat pushing his way up into the fourth place. But look at Shirker's like, I ain't giving that up yet.
Wow, Shirker made the pass. So what happened there is Helm came a little bit wide. Shirker went wider, tucked up inside, and then had a better line from the right side red buoy to the double yellows. Shirker took advantage of that line. He was hard on the throttle and made the pass.
Which is interesting, because I talked to Rick Shirker yesterday, and I was like, how are you liking racing the surf? And he's like, you know, Don, I just don't practice it all that much, right? So it always feels a little uncomfortable to me. Certainly doesn't look that way to us right now. Halfway mark is out. You got Shirker back there in third. You've got Derek Helm in fourth. You have got Kelber, I do believe, in fifth. Meanwhile, your top two riders, Chris McCluggage, Jimmy Wilson, and a speedboat coming quite close, actually, to the backside of that course.
Well, you know, that wake's going to come through, too, and it's going to be at a slightly different angle than the waves as he's taken off at kind of a, across that back straightaway at like a 30 degree. So we'll see what happens to that as they come around the front straightaway and work their way back out into the waves and the boat wake at the same time.
Of course, Marshall's very quick to push that boat out of the way and keep our riders safe. Meanwhile, that surf continues to increase in size as the tide is lifting, going up to high tide at 4 p.m. today. Taking a look down here on the left-hand side of the track, coming onto the front stretch, you guys. He's got kind of an orange, red-looking life jacket. That's your leader, Chris McCluggage.
Well, it looked like Jimmy Wilson went down for a second in the outside split section, so I do believe that was him down in his tray. He's still up. Now he's back up. So Jimmy Wilson taking a little siesta there for a minute as McCluggage is allowed now to stretch his lead a little bit further.
Another little technical area of the track that we had been discussing. If you take a look, again, this far left-hand side by the pier, right? That big red buoy right by the pier, that final buoy before they come in and pick a split. That's another area that both Dylan Osborne and Chris McCluggage had told me earlier. Those waves have a tendency to drop out right underneath that. It is like a little Bermuda Triangle over there.
So that gives McCluggage a little bit of breathing room as Jimmy Wilson was down in the tray for a minute. Look at the air these guys are getting over on the right side. Boy, I tell you what, Don, this course just seems to have gotten rougher and rougher and more difficult as the day goes by.
Good news for us.
Yeah.
Because we get the opportunity to watch all of this, and it's usually, you know, the opposite wave. So it's really cool to see the pros getting to handle some expert wave action. That's what's happening.
How about it, Atlantic City, New Jersey? We've got some hot racing action going on here. This is the last race of the pro show for the day. Come on, folks, put your hands together. This is Pro AM Ski GP, the fastest skis in the world, right here in Atlantic City, and you are seeing the action unfold in front of your eyes.
Nay, I just got a quick announcement for you. So right after this, going to be our final race. Man, I want to say a thank you so much for hanging out with us, but we are keeping all of the courtyard signs up, and here's the reason for that. We're going to keep that beach closed, Mike, until we get all of the buoys in and we're able to retrieve all of the equipment, get all the course marshal boats in, and make sure that we leave the beach exactly how we found it, nice and pristine for you, and then we'll open it back up. But for right now, that beach is going to stay closed, and that's for your safety as well as ours. Thank you, guys. Back out on the track, I see the lap buoy coming out, and that is because the Mac Attack is working the front stretch again, and he is working his way through a couple of lappers. Chris McCluggage.
David Cabrera is 49.
Yeah, I do believe
Bill Hanks, 52.
The oldest person out there is the Hurricane, or the Flying Tennis Ball, and that would be Bill Haig. But Chris McCluggage, not the spring chicken, certainly has not slowed him down one iota. Oh, I did notice Jimmy kind of poking at him in a fun way in the interview.
I was just going to bring that up. When you interviewed Jimmy earlier, he said, well, you know, maybe Mac isn't quite as fast as he was back in the day.
That was.
And I wondered if McCluggage heard that and if that was going to, yeah, a little bit of salt in the wound, a little bit of poke in there. Obviously, McCluggage brought his A game in this moto as he is checked out of this thing.
Did you just call me old? I don't think so. I think that's what just happened in this moto. All right, well, the young gun versus the Wiley veteran going at it, and it is McCluggage who's working his way off of that front stretch, and man, I tell you what, he set that turn up perfectly.
He's so strategic. You can just see the wheels turning. I mean, as he comes down that front straightaway, he's looking for the opportunity, looking for where he wants to put that machine, looking for his line, and he's just so smart. That's really one of the things that the veterans have in common is once you've been on a race course hundreds and thousands of times, you're that good.
Yeah, and I see Jimmy Wilson just finishing up the front stretch. It was David Cabrera right next to him, and Jimmy Wilson biding his time back there. He knows where he is on the position on the scoreboard. He knows he's in the hunt for this podium. Right now, it is that battle between him. They're tied, as you had talked about, coming into this, both with a 1-2 finish. And even Chris McCluggage says, just going to make this race even more fun. But as we click down on these laps in this 12-minute moto, you got to just hand it to the Mac Attack. He's the one in control of this race at the moment.
So Derek Helm down the front straightaway, who was in the hunt for a while there as well. He was running third for a while and then fourth. Now, do we know, Don, that we still got Chris McCluggage out in front in first. We've got Jimmy Wilson in second. And did we deem that
it's Derek,
circuit
actually
was in third?
Yeah, it's actually Derek back up in third.
So Derek Helm has made the move back into third, and Shirker's now running fourth?
Correct. And I'm going to say it's Kelberer still top five. instructed the GP class. Now, we talked earlier about the runabouts being the fastest sit-downs on the water. But when you come to the ski class, guys, this is the fastest skis on the water, and the white flag comes out for Chris McCluggage, gentleman sponsored by Monster Energy, as well as Mack Racing and Broward Motorsports, and a Jet Trim sponsored rider as well. And this is going to be his final lap, final opportunity to play in the surf, one of his favorite things to do.
He is, and it really looks like he knows where he is. He knows what position he's maintaining. It looks like he's just backing off a little bit and actually playing in the surf. Going to enjoy this last half lap as if it were a victory lap, because it is.
Now, the gentleman right behind him with the blue helmet that's also just finishing up that front stretch, Jimmy Wilson, gentleman out of Sanford, North Carolina. And Jimmy in that second place spot. And, of course, he also has got some killer sponsors to include Judge Motorsports and, of course, Tim Judge underneath the hood working on his boats. Jam Racing, Hidden Trails Motorsports, also just some of his great sponsors.
Here comes McCluggage down the front straightaway. He's about to take the checkered flag as he's going to poke his way across. He knows he's that far ahead. He rode an incredible Moto 3. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for your Pro-Am Ski GP champion at the Atlantic City Round here, fifth round of the Pro Watercross Tour, Chris McCluggage.
Nicely done. And it's going to be the young gun that we got a chance to talk to earlier, Jimmy Wilson, that's going to take that second place spot. And I love how both of them dropped it down like they were running in the no-wake zone. We'd just be chilling the last 300 yards or so. Checker flag still up as Derek Helm comes through. That'll be our call and officially for your third place. And then Shirker, fourth. Josh Block. It's going to be Josh Block or Kelberer for fifth. Ladies and gentlemen, that's going to be a wrap for the racing side of this for the Hidden Trails CDU Pro Watercross National Tour, round number five. We're going to take a quick break, and we're going to go to the close on the live feed and give these guys the props for once again breaking a record. want to say a special thanks, you guys. I'm Don Dawson. This is Mike Remar. And you guys have been hanging out with us for round number 5 right here in Atlantic City, New Jersey. We can't go very far in this when we do the sign-off without first saying a special thanks to Atlantic City, New Jersey. Thank you so much for being our host this weekend. You have undoubtedly taken it to the next level. It's the first time I was able to hang out in Atlantic City, and I am not only impressed, but I'm also inspired by how much fun this has been and how sweet and generous you guys have been.
Yeah, I mean, Atlantic City, like I said, I can't say it enough. They've rolled out the red carpet. The fans were amazing. I like to say it this way. They shared their beach with us. We shared our sport with them, and it made for an incredible marriage for this weekend's activities.
Beautifully said. Also, a huge props and shout out to the Steel Pier and also to the Resort Hotel and Casino. We have most certainly been spoiled rotten, no question about it. Now, talking about this awesome marriage, this has been what's happening with this marriage this weekend, and that has been some incredible racing. Here's the recipe, right? We had great surf all weekend long and some outrageously fast riders. Let's talk a little bit about that. Even though we didn't have Dustin and Tyron here, which I miss, we certainly had Commander representing with David Redinger, and then, of course, the Mac Attack back in for surf racing, who's awesome to watch.
Yeah, the Mac Attack, you know, he really brought his A game that last race, Pro Ski GP. You know, he and Jimmy Wilson went at it earlier. Mac missed a buoy after a wardrobe malfunction, mind you. Picked up the extra buoy to come back into it, and right down to it was nearly a photo finish. So it was pretty awesome to see those two go at it again. And Mac, like I said, really brought his A game in that last Moto 3 and picked up the overall win here.
Yeah, he certainly did, but not without a lot of hard effort. And it's because of this young man who's also a firefighter during the work week. And that, of course, is Jimmy Wilson, boat number 300, and that Judge Motorsports. Bam. That was your recipe for some awesome racing and ski. Let's go to the runabout class and the GP and King D back to it with the winning ways.
Yeah, Farthing was just incredible. I mean, he pulled a killer hole shot. His boat was so fast, and, you know, he was just checking out. I saw a couple of lapped riders try to give him a little bit of run just to see where their boat stands. Obviously, still giving him way as he was lapping them. That boat is sick fast, and you know Farthing rides it like no other.
Yeah, he certainly does, and I tell you what, he once again took that Sea-Doo right to the finish line and the checkered flag. Right behind him, though, was the Tweaker, one of our favorite riders, Brian Baldwin, back in the house, and he too said, I am going to bring it. I got my guns. I'm ready to go. He ended up in second, and Tim Ducat, this guy just keeps getting faster and faster. That was your recipe and also your podium.
Yeah, you know, Tim Ducat, he really rode hard. He had a couple of technical difficulties, and in fact, in the runabout GP class, it really was a war of attrition today. In Moto 2 this morning, we saw a lot of machines not finish, but in the end, it was what, Farthing, and then Baldwin, and then Ducat able to go the distance.
Yeah, and I tell you what, here's a guy that I thought was just a closed course racer. Apparently, I was wrong. He also does freestyle, and that's Sam Neamy in that sports GP class. The gentleman that looked like he was starting to go for a scarecrow on the start on that final moto. He certainly put the scare into all of his teammates, but even with that, getting out of that gate, going sideways, was in third, went all the way up to the lead. That is exactly how you take home a tour title, and this guy has been on fire.
Yeah, Sam Neamy, and if you think about it, in Moto 2 from this morning, remember, he got called for a jump or whatever. He had to start with a dead machine and his hand up. He still pulled the win on that one, and then with the near dismount, the scarecrow, as you call it, in Moto 3, he came back for a Moto 1, Moto 2, and Moto 3 win. That guy's incredible.
Yeah, I think if you were doing that on the craps table, that'd be like you kept rolling sevens or something. He was like, I don't care if I'm rolling sevens. I'm still going to take home the win. That is just some of the action that we saw this weekend on the Hidden Trails Sea-Doo Pro Watercross National Tour. But don't you go anywhere. Stay tuned. Hook it up with prowatercross.com. Like us on Facebook because we're not done with you yet, you awesome ones. We are going to be right back. Round number 6 in Hartwell, Georgia. And Remar, I don't know about you, but I'm just thinking this roof continues to be raised. Huge props to Rick Ignacio and all the gang. What? A 500,000 viewers. What? We love you guys. Thank you.
500,000 viewers. And, you know, this, we should take this time just to give a shout-out to the whole Pro Watercross team. They put on an excellent event. So much work has to take place behind the scenes. It's something that maybe the racers don't realize and the fans don't realize. But this is a professional show. I'm glad to have been part of it. Thanks for having me.
Oh, my gosh. It was our pleasure. It was like you never stopped. You stepped up here. You're such a pro. Remar, we really, really appreciate it. Obviously, too much fun. By the way, I have to just tell you, it was like a chipmunk over here that just got a whole bag of extra acorns. He was like, it's not 500, Don. It's 600,000. 600,000. I don't know how much more viral you can go, but I guess we're on the roll for this goal of 1 million viewers right here on Pro Watercross. Huge shout out to all of our crew, all of our sponsors. Obviously, visit West Virginia. We're about to visit West Virginia. Thank you for sponsoring the stream. Huge shout to our new sponsors for the 2016 tour, Shark Energy Drink, of course, the Too Cool for TV Bomber Eyewears. We've also got all the other great sponsors, Hidden Trails, Sea-Doo. I'll tell you more about them. I actually think that Rick is once again going to tell me, Dawn, I have it on a CG. You don't have to say everyone. Anyway, Mike Reamer, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you. It's been fun. Why don't you sign us out, Don?
All right. On behalf of us and all of the crew for the Pro Watercross team, we will see you at round number 6 as we continue the tour de force for Pro Watercross right here. We'll be back.